Today we discuss one of the most important questions of our daily life as well as of our national economy, namely the question of national income and its distribution. Well, in the meanwhile, two of our friends, Tanushree and David, had come to me with a few questions for clarification, and I shall try to dwell on them also. National income and its distribution, as you know, were the main focus of attention of the founder of modern economics, Adam Smith. Well, Adam Smith thought that the total national output of an economy, net of material productions, constituted the national dividend to the economy, shared out as income by the three great orders of society, namely the landlords, the capitalists, and the laborers. But in an economy like ours, for instance, which is a pre-industrial society in the process of, or let us say on the threshold of an industrial revolution, these three orders of society are not that sharply demarcated always.
Is it because we are yet to have our industrial revolution?
Or is it because the industrial revolution can take place only when such sharp divisions in society exist?
Well, the answer is not that simple. For the industrial revolution to take place, it is essential that households and firms get separated. But this separation of households from firms takes place often through a very painful process. Now, in England, for instance, the separation of households from firms took place through a large-scale eviction of peasants from the countryside, from their lands. They were then herded out into the towns, even called sturdy beggars, and that's the world of Charles Dickens. You might have read Dickens's Oliver Twist.
Yes, sir.
Now, Oliver Twists are there all over the place in our country, working as, let us say, in a dhaba or in a motor mechanics workshop. They are even working as construction workers.
Not only children, sir, we also see women working as construction laborers at very low wages. Do you mean to say this is a part of the Industrial Revolution?
Well, not quite. You see, the process of Industrial Revolution involves, as I said, the separation of households from firms. Now let us look at a farmer in and around Delhi even.
ये हमारा पांच बीघा जमीन है, अपना हल बैल चलाते हैं और इसमें भिंडी लगाते हैं और दो कुंटल करीब करीब भिंडी रख लेते हैं और मंडी को भेज देते हैं.
Well, the farmer owns his own land. He produces, let us say, wheat, takes it to the market for sale, keeps part of it at home for consumption. The same holds true of a milkman who owns the cattle, feeds them, looks after them, he and his family, milks them, takes the milk for sale on a, let us say, bicycle. You see that every day. Now these are landlords, capitalists and laborers at the same time.
Then how does this separation take place?
In the Industrial Revolution, through the Industrial Revolution in England and the processes before and after it or accompanying it, these hundreds of thousands of peasants were thrown out. Now the same kind of process is going on all the time in our country at this point of time, or has been going on, well, maybe since the advent of the railways or even before that, in the middle of the 19th century. You get the picture of the countryside, for instance, in Premchand's novels or short stories. In Sadgati, for instance.
Yes, sir. We remember seeing a film based on Sadgati, which was made by Satyajit Ray. In this film, the laborer called Dukhi goes to his master's house to get his daughter's sai thread, and his master orders him to cut wood, paying him many wages. And he has to work in spite of being hungry.
सुबह से कुछ खाया नहीं महाराज.
तो क्या काम पूरा करके अपने घर जाना और खा ला झटके. लकड़ी तो अभी जो की त्यों पड़ी है, शायद भी वैसे ही निकलेगा. मुझे दोष मत देना. चलो शुरू कर. हाथ में तो जैसे दम ही नहीं. लगा कसके. हल हन के मारना जब तक गांठ फट न जाए.
Yeah, that's a memorable sequence. Now, Bukhi was possibly doing begar, as it's called, which bonded laborers are forced to provide, which is free labor service, for some kind of a bondage, to which we shall come later. Well, Dukhis run away from the countryside, from the situation of hunger and bondage, which is depicted in Sadgati. And they come and get herded out or herded into the cities, even in Delhi. You get the Jhuggi Jhopris, the resettlement colonies.
Yes, sir, we have visited a Jhuggi Jhopri colony in Delhi. We have seen that people in these places live in very unhygienic conditions. They drink the same water which animals use.
Yeah, and that's how you had a cholera epidemic in the city.
But what you have described so far is merely the process of impoverishment and destitution resulting in migration and suffering. How is that connected to the Industrial Revolution?
One need not presume that this process of immiserization or destitution is a necessary condition of the Industrial Revolution. But that's how things have happened. In fact, the very purpose of planning is to minimize the costs of the Industrial Revolution. Now, as you know, Industrial Revolution needs something more than merely impoverishment or destitution. It has to have processes giving rise to a process of increasing productivity of labor.
But sir, I have heard that raise in productivity is largely because of the employment of capital and machinery.
Capital and machinery, well, capital is machinery and equipment which are aids to labor. That's how they raise the productivity of labor. But it is the rising productivity of labor which feeds the process of generation of output as well as capital. That's the process which is the source of capital accumulation also. But rising productivity of labor in turn, according to Adam Smith, is a consequence of increasing division of labor in society. Division of labor both on the social scale, that is extensive division of labor, and intensive division of labor, which is internal to an establishment.
Would you say, sir, that our caste system is also a kind of division of labor, and doesn't that determine, particularly in the countryside, the nature of distribution of income?
Some people say that the origins of the caste system lie in the occupational division of labor. In fact, Max Weber said so. Once that occupational division of labor becomes hereditary, and that certainly affects the distribution of income. But the process of separation of households and firms and the process of the Industrial Revolution also breaks down these hereditary barriers to mobility of occupations from one to the other.
Is there any other kind of division of labor?
Well, yes, and sometimes that's more important. Well, that's internal division of labor, as I had just now said. And, well, you might have seen your mother or your aunt or any elderly lady doing a button to your shirt or to your trousers or darning a sari. You might have noticed the fingers going up and down with the needle on as she sews up. Now, this simple movement of the fingers going up and down, when delegated to a needle driven by a wheel, the wheel being turned by the hand or by the paddle, then the movement of the needle is much faster and the stitching is much faster. That's speeding up the labor process. Rather, the total production process can be subdivided into simple operations, which can then be delegated to mechanical movements. And then these mechanical movements can be driven by energy or power other than human or animal power. The conditions for such external as well as internal division of labor, which require bulk production and bulk trade, are laid by, the conditions are laid by, the separation of households from farms. Households and farms in a modern industrial society cooperate. The farms having the capital, the equipment, the households providing the labor services and even the entrepreneurial abilities. And the exchange between the household and the firm then generates a circular flow of output, income and expenditure, which we can now see in the two diagrams which are depicted in your books, the block one which has been received by you already. The first one, we have only households and firms. There is no government, nor is there any savings or investment. Households provide factor services and receive factor payments. That's the lower loop. On the upper loop, you get the factor services employed by firms generate final goods and services. By final goods and services, we mean such goods which can be immediately used for consumption. These final goods and services are then the national product. And then this national product is used up through consumption expenditures undertaken by the households, who spend the factor incomes, which is national, the total of which is national income, on consumption expenditure for the purchase of final goods and services. So these groups are equal. Now in this diagram, you have households, firms, government, then investment expenditure as well as savings. Now, households, as before, provide the factor services to the factor markets, through the factor markets to the firms. They receive the factor payments, which is their national income. This national income, part of it goes, the larger part of it goes into consumption expenditure on the production markets, but part of this income is then saved and goes through the financial markets as investment to the firms. The firms then undertake the investment expenditure. Now within the circle of flow, once the government enters, it enters at a number of points. It withdraws a part of the flow through taxes and borrowings. It may also inject resources into the flow through expenditures, government expenditures. Now, by accounting definition, national income, national output, and national expenditure, they are identical.
But sir, does this equality always hold?
Well, it is only an identity in accounting sense. In the real world, total national expenditure can exceed total national output or may fall short. Now, expenditure, which is demand, may fall short of output, which is supply. Or expenditure, which is demand, may exceed output, which is supply. In that case, you have inflation. In the former case, when expenditure, that is demand, falls short of output, that is supply, you may end up with a lot of idle capacity and unemployment. As you know, during the Great Depression of 1929-32, there was massive underemployment of production capacity, as well as a large part of the labor force was thrown out of work in advanced capitalist countries of the world, creating what is known as the Great Depression. And came John Maynard Keynes, who argued that contrary to the presumptions of the classical economists like Smith and Ricardo, the market left to itself might not necessarily create sufficient effective demand, that is expenditure, to absorb the total production capacity or to absorb the total available labor supply at the going wage rate or at the going prices, thereby creating conditions of large-scale unemployment and idle production capacities. Now we turn to the mechanism through which Keynes proposed to correct the failures of the market, through largely a process of government intervention to bring back national income to a level of equilibrium which is full employment equilibrium. We now turn to these diagrams which deal with the 45 degree line. As you can see in this diagram, on this 45 degree line, at any point, aggregate expenditure is equal to real national income. They are all in real terms, prices being held constant. Here you have the consumption function, which is the consumption-income relation. We assume that consumption would just fall short of total income in the aggregate, though for the lower income groups, consumption may even exceed income and they may run into debts. Now, to this consumption income relation, we add investment, and then we have this E1 line, which cuts the 45 degree line at this point. This is one equilibrium point, where OY1, real national income, is equal to the corresponding aggregate expenditure on the vertical axis. If we added on another dose of investment, which is delta I, then this whole straight line shifts upwards. And you have a new equilibrium level at Y2, and real national income has increased from OYN to OY2. Now the same thing is depicted in the other diagram in terms of the saving income relation. See, saving income relation is just the obverse of the consumption income relation. What is not consumed is saved.
Yes, sir.
And it depicts in the same manner how by introducing a dose of investment, this line shifts up and real national income moves from OY1 to OY2. The other diagrams, well, you get that in your block 3. The other two diagrams depict the same situation through changes in the consumption function itself. The equilibrium level of national income may change either through a dose of additional investment or by a change in the shape of the consumption function. That is, let us say, by redistribution of income. As I said, the lower income groups tend to consume more. So if income is redistributed in favor of the lower income groups, then there will be a shift in the consumption function. The slope of the consumption function will change. And you can have the same kind of a shift in real national income and equilibrium level of real national income from OY1 to OY2. Now, of course, the purpose of all this for John Maynard Keynes was to show that the government can enter the picture and undertake the necessary investments to push up effective demand to the level of full employment national income.
But sir, won't this equilibrium be somehow dependent on how the total material income is distributed?
Yeah, yes, of course. But let me also mention to you that there is a mistake in that diagram 6.11 in your book, and we will be correcting that in an errata sheet. Now, the equilibrium level of national income would be influenced quite significantly by the distribution of income. As I said, when the consumption function shifts like that, there is an implicit assumption of redistribution of income. This redistribution of income across income groups would also involve a redistribution of the functional distribution of income across rent, wages, profit and interest. Now we have dealt with a little bit of what we know to be wages, and that is, well, so common that I need not dwell on that. Everybody who works for a living earns wages in some form or the other. Wage earners who don't have property save none or save very little. Property earners are supposed to save. But property earners have different kinds of income. Profit, rent and interest.
So how are these profits determined?
Well, economists have very different kinds of answers to that. Well, in fact, all the time we talk of maximization of profits, but we really don't have a theory of profits as yet on which there is some consensus. But profits usually are considered to be a residual. Residual of the sale proceeds after all contractual payments have been made, such as the contractual payments to the laborers, the salaried employees, the contractual payments made for the space you occupy, which is rent, the contractual payments you have made for the capital you have borrowed, which is interest. After all this is paid out, what is left is the residual called profit.
But sir, isn't the rent supposed to be the accrue of owners of land only?
Well, rent is supposed to accrue to the owners of land only within the Ricardian framework. That was how it started. That was because land, as one can see, I mean, this is common sense, the availability of land to a national economy is fixed even in the long run. That's the only factor of production which can't be augmented. And therefore, rent, which is a kind of surplus, which is not because of any productive service as such, is earned by landlords because of their monopoly rights over of property over land. And since land was fixed in supply, you added, if you go on adding additional doses of capital and labor, at some point there will be diminishing returns, so that the units before diminishing returns really set in a big way and rendered the cost of production equal to the price, the market price, units before that would be earning a surplus. And that would be accruing to land only. Now, this is a little confusing, but the concept of this concept of surplus was then taken over and then extended to all factors of production and not merely land. Because in the short run, every factor of production, whether it is land, labor or capital, would have an alternative use from which it is being lured into its current use. To be lured into its current use, it will have to be paid little more than what it is going to earn in alternative use. So this margin, which is the transfer margin, which are called the transfer earning by Mrs. Robinson, this is also in the nature of rent. For instance, a doctor who undertakes private practice rather than being employed in government service does so because he thinks that the second best alternative, which is government service, would fetch him a lower income.
Now what about interest? The pot-bellied fellow we saw in the strip from Sadgati, who had such control over Dukhi, probably because Dukhi or even his father or grandfather had taken a loan from the Mahajan. There are Mahajans in Delhi also, and we had gone to see one.
Namaste Lala ji.
Namaste Ben ji.
ये क्या कर रहे हैं आप यहाँ पे?
ये बहन जी, हम अपने ब्याज बट्टे का हिसाब किताब कर रहे हैं. जो लोग हमसे पैसा ले जाते हैं, खेती बाड़ी हम करते हैं, आगे और कई काम करते हैं, वो बहुत पैसा कमाते हैं, और जो वो पैसा ले जाते हैं वो हमको लिखना पड़ता है.
ब्याज कितना लेते हैं आप?
बहुत थोड़ा सा ब्याज, जिससे उनका भी काम चल जावे और हमारा भी काम चल जावे.
दीज महाजन्स ऑल्सो चार्ज वेरी हाई रेट्स ऑफ इंटरेस्ट ऑफन, आई मीन समटाइम्स वीकली और मंथली रेट्स व्हिच आर several times greater than the bank rate of interest, for instance. That's possible because money markets in our country are still quite fragmented. You have different segments of the money market, and there is not much mobility across these segments. And rent and interest are both deductions from profit. They are both property income, like profit, unlike wages, which is labor income. But even though they are property income, they constitute deductions from profit. And Ricardo and Adam Smith thought, and even some of these modern economists, they also think that it is profit which constitutes the mainspring of investment and economic growth. We shall turn to the question of the logic and the process of economic growth and development in the context of an underdeveloped economy in the next video.